Dozens of people, including U.S. troops, have been killed in Afghanistan as suicide bombers targeted Kabul's airport. With a recent attack, the airlifting of tens of thousands of Afghans desperate to flee the country since the Taliban took over has ground to a halt. The Pentagon says that there were at least two explosions, one of which appeared to be a suicide bombing. 13 U.S. service members were among the casualties, while video images uploaded by Afghan journalists showed dozens of bodies of locals. According to the Taliban, 52 were wounded, and that figure could be higher. The Islamic State has claimed responsibility for this attack. The U.S. and its allies had earlier urged Afghans to leave the airport due to a threat posed by Islamist militants. But a Western diplomat says that the areas outside the airport's gates were still crowded despite these warnings. Meanwhile, the Philippine Foreign Affairs Department says that preliminary information indicates that no Filipino was hurt during these bombings at the airport. U.S. President Joe Biden vows to hunt down those behind the twin explosions at the Kabul airport. Biden says he has ordered commanders to take the maximum steps necessary to protect the U.S. forces in Kabul. Biden has also asked the Pentagon to develop plans to strike back at the Islamic State.
We will not forget. We will hunt you down and make you pay. I will defend our interests and our people with every measure at my command.
U.S. General Frank McKenzie, the head of the U.S. Central Command, says that the threat from the Islamic State groups and others persists and that the Pentagon is bracing for more attacks. But he asserts that the evacuation mission will not stop. The U.S. military has been racing to carry out the airlifting before their August 31st deadline to fully withdraw from Afghanistan.
The threat from ISIS is extremely real. We've been talking about this for several days. We saw it actually manifest itself here in the last few hours with an actual attack. We believe it is their desire to continue those attacks, and we expect those attacks to continue. And we're doing everything we can to be prepared for those attacks. That includes reaching out to the Taliban, who are actually providing the outer security cordon around the airfield, to make sure they know what we expect them to do to protect us. And we will continue to coordinate with them as they go forward.
U.S. flags at the White House and at all public buildings and grounds are now being flown at half-mast to honor the fallen troops in Kabul. The attack marks the first U.S. military casualty on Afghan soil since February 2020. It's also the deadliest incident for American troops in that country in a decade. ISIS-K, the Islamic State affiliate, which claimed responsibility for the recent attack, is a sworn enemy of the Taliban. United Nations Secretary General Antonio Guterres denounces the deadly attack at Kabul's airport. Guterres says that he's following the situation with grave concern. He also says that while this incident underscores the volatility of Afghanistan, it also strengthens their resolve to continue to deliver urgent assistance to the Afghan people.
Well, I'd like to express in the strongest possible way my total condemnation about the horrific terrorist attack in Kabul, to send my condolences to the families of all those that perished, Afghans, and those that were helping there, the Afghans, and died serving the lives of others.
International non-governmental organization Doctors Without Borders says that their supply situation in Afghanistan has become a massive concern. According to Paul McFun, the head of Southeast and East Asia for Doctors Without Borders, the group's contingent in Afghanistan only has enough supplies for a couple of more weeks. The group has around 1,200 staff members providing healthcare assistance to five provinces in Afghanistan. McFun is also worried that the overall humanitarian support for Afghanistan may never return to the level seen before the Taliban's takeover.
Yeah, so again, I mean, a huge question mark is where are things going to go from here? I mean, what is going to be the humanitarian response of the future? And given everything that's taken place, are the organizations that have left going to be able to come back? Is there going to be funding from the international community, as we've seen in the past, to sustain this sort of scale of support that the country has very much relied on? And nobody can answer that yet. I think that this is a big concern.